And welcome back to the Cloud Church. I'm Robert Breaker, Missionary Evangelist to the Spanish and English speaking people. This sermon for this Sunday is on the topic of baptism. This is something I've been dealing with a lot lately. I've run into some people that have talked about this and said they believe a certain thing about it. I actually have gotten several emails from people saying, hey, why don't you preach a message on baptism? So I thought, well, I guess now's the time. Usually when you're going through stuff and the Lord shows you some things, I guess that's the time to deal with it and preach on it. At least I've found in my ministry that oftentimes the thing that's on your heart and that you're dealing with is the thing that God wants you to preach on. So I'm going to preach on today the subject of baptism. Now, sure in the world, as I said the word baptism, you most likely thought of water baptism. But there is more than one kind of baptism in the Bible. In a matter of fact, there are seven different baptisms in the Bible. A lot of people don't know that. They think there's one baptism, and that's water baptism. But what I'm going to preach today about is the different kinds of baptism. I'm not going to preach on all seven baptisms. That's a completely different message. I think I'll only look at about three or four different types of baptisms in the Bible today. And then we'll look at what the Bible says about it, because there's a lot of people out there that are confused about this subject of baptism. So let's begin in Matthew chapter 3, verses 11 and 12. Because in these verses, we find three different baptisms in one verse. Three very distinct different baptisms in one verse. Matthew chapter 3, verse 11. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And then the King James Bible has a semicolon at the end of that verse, saying that what follows ties into the last word, fire. And this fire, what is this fire? You know, there's a lot of charismatics go around saying, oh God, give me the baptism of fire. Is that really something you should be praying for? What is the baptism of fire? Verse 12 says, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with an unquenchable fire. Now, if you know your story about the wheat and the tares, you know what that is. That's the end of the world. That fire, that baptism of fire, is not for a Christian. It's for the lost people. They'll be burnt. They'll be flames of fire literally burning them with unquenchable fire as they die and spend an eternity in hell. So we find three very, very different baptisms in these verses. So let me just go ahead and write up here a couple of these baptisms that I'm going to talk about today. We have, of course, water baptism. Then this verse talks about being baptized in the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit. Then we have there mentioned a baptism of fire. I think I'll go ahead and show you one or two other baptisms real quick. And then I'm really going to deal with these main three baptisms in this verse. But another baptism is found in Matthew chapter 20, verse 20 through 23. And this is the Lord Jesus Christ speaking. And Jesus Christ was baptized in water, as we shall see. But he also went through a baptism that you shouldn't pray for. In Matthew chapter 20, verse 20 through 23, the Bible says, then came to him the mother of Zebedee, children with her sons, worshipping him and desiring a certain thing of him. And he said unto her, what wilt thou? She said to him, grant that these my two sons may sit the one on thy right hand and the other on thy left hand in thy kingdom. But Jesus answered and said, ye know not what ye ask. Are you able to drink of the cup that I shall drink of, and to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? Well, they didn't know what he was talking about. So they said unto him, we are able. And he said to them, ye shall indeed drink of my cup, and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with. But to sit in my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them to whom it is prepared of my Father. What was Jesus talking about? He was talking about a baptism of suffering. When Jesus went to the cross and died on the cross, it was a baptism of suffering. Jesus Christ suffered for us. And these selfish disciples came to Jesus and wanted to sit on his right hand and his left hand in the kingdom. And Jesus said, can you be baptized with this baptism? And they said, yes, we can. And God said, okay, you sure will be. and the disciples of Jesus Christ died a horrible, horrible martyr's death. They also had the baptism of suffering. So, that's another one of the seven baptisms. The fourth one is the baptism of suffering. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And I was telling my wife the other day, I want to preach on baptism. I believe that's what the Lord would have me to preach on. And she said, oh, honey, that's too long. And I realized the last couple of sermons that I've preached have gone a little long. So I'm going to try to keep this short. But I need to explain this because this is so important. I've got some friends who are lost because they don't understand this teaching of baptism. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 2. It says, let's start in verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea and were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Well, this is a baptism of Israel. And this is a baptism of them at the Exodus. So it was a baptism, how would I even explain this? This is the baptism of to a cloud or to the sea. Something that took place in the Exodus. If you go way back to the book of Genesis, I'll just put Exodus, in which when they escaped from the city of Israel, the country of Egypt, God literally says they were baptized as they went through the Red Sea. It was like God was baptizing the entire nation of Israel, cleansing them in order to bring them into His holy land, into His holy place. So we have five different baptisms. I could go into the other two, but I won't right now. But I want to take and look at these baptisms. These first three will be the ones we'll be dealing with. I could go into the others. I think I might mention a little bit about four. But mostly I'm going to talk about these three baptisms. Because when you say the word baptism, you need to define what you're talking about. The Bible doesn't talk about just one sort or one type of baptism. There's several different types. What does the word baptism mean? Well, the word baptism means immersion. It means to actually immerse yourself or be immersed under something. Which is funny, there's a lot of people who say sprinkling. I believe that was the Methodist church years ago. And there was a big debate in the Protestant circles of how to baptize in water. And they'd say, no, you have to completely immerse underwater. And they'd say, no, you have to sprinkle. And they'd fight back and forth. Well, in the Bible, when they baptize in water, they completely dunk them under and brought them back up. So the sprinkling argument is a little silly. Sprinkling did take place, but in the Old Testament, it was for the Jews. And there was a time when they were sprinkled with water. But that's not for us today. So let's begin with this first baptism, baptism of water. And let's see what the Bible has to say about it. Well, we need to realize that this baptism is always connected with Jews. And that's something a lot of people don't understand today. Here's my little timeline up here. Let me go ahead and draw this out. Here you have Adam, the first man. A little later, you had Noah and the flood. Then God called out Abraham. And then God used Moses. Well, with Moses, God set up what was called the law. And you can go to the Cloud Church and look up the difference of the teaching between the law and grace. Well, here we have a little time period when God sent a guy named John. I want to talk a lot about John because John did a lot of water baptism. Well, after John was the ministry of Jesus. And Jesus died on the cross. Well, after Jesus, there was the time known as the church age. And then at the end of the church age, of course, is the rapture. And we won't get into the tribulation today, I don't think. So here's the church age. And when the church age started, it started with Jewish apostles. And Peter. But then the church age changed to the ministry of Paul. And we'll look at the book of Acts. Oh, Pete. I should have put Peter. There we go. And we'll look at the book of Acts as well. Because this topic of water baptism is so important. And the reason is there are some people today that say you have to be baptized in water to be saved. Is that true? What does water do? Well, water gets the flesh clean. But Jesus Christ came to die on the cross to save your soul. You see, I don't care how many times you baptize yourself, how many baths you take, you're never going to touch the soul. The only thing that, according to the Bible, can cleanse your soul is Jesus. And He does it with a different liquid, and that liquid is not water. So these people that say water baptism saves you, they don't rightly divide the word of truth. If you haven't yet, go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, And verse 15, because 2 Timothy 2:15 tells us to study to show thyself approved of God, rightly dividing the word of truth. And what we're going to do today, we're going to look at these baptisms. We're going to rightly divide the word of truth. We're going to look at what the Bible says about water baptism and whether or not it's for salvation for us. Like I say, some people say, oh, yes, it is. Salvation today is by, there's a group out there called the Church of Christ, and the Church of Christ says, this is how you're saved, by water baptism. But is that true? Is that biblical? So what is water baptism? Well, if you look at the Bible, you find that water baptism is always connected with Jews. So I ask you, are you a Jew? Many of these people today who claim to be Christians, who believe that water baptism will save them, they're not Jews. So why are they going and trying to get something to them that was applying to the Jews that God doesn't apply to us who are Gentiles today? Why do they do that? It's because they don't rightly divide the word of truth. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 8 through 10. And the Bible says this, Hebrews 9, 8 through 10. The Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience. Now verse 10, which stood only in meats and drinks, and it says, and diverse washings and cardinal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. Now this is talking about the time of the law. The time of Reformation would be when Jesus Christ came, and he started the New Testament. Everything past the cross of Christ is the New Testament. Everything before is the Old Testament. That Old Testament that God gave. And how did it come? Well, a testament starts at the death of a testator. So the death of Jesus Christ began the New Testament, the New Covenant. Salvation by blood rather than by water. But notice in verse 10, it uses the term diverse washings. Diverse washings. Well, what is that? Well, a lot of people say that water baptism, that's what it is. It's a washing. And some people believe that water baptism literally washes your sins away. But is that true? Well, as we go back to the Old Testament, let's go to Exodus chapter 19. Exodus chapter 19, we find that the washing, or the washing of the body over and over, being cleansed by this water, was something that was always Jewish, always to the Jews. Exodus chapter 19, 5 through 10. And God is talking to the Levitical priesthood, and he says, verse 5, now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. Notice, the children of Israel. And Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord commanded him. And all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord hath spoken we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with thee and believe thee with forever. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. And be ready against the third day. And the third day the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. And so there was a washing. They had to wash their clothes. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 30, verse 18. Here we find to the Levitical priesthood. Now, I said it was Levitical priesthood, the one before. The verse I just read was to all the people of Israel. Now this, what I'm about to read, is to the priesthood. Exodus chapter 30, verse 18. Exodus 30, 18 says, thou shalt also make a laver of brass, and his foot also of brass, to wash withal, and thou shalt put it between the tabernacle of the congregation and the altar, and thou shalt put water therein. For Aaron and his sons shall wash their hands and their feet thereat. When they shall go into the tabernacle of the congregation, they shall wash with water, that they die not. So they had to be clean to appear before God. Or when they come near the altar to minister, to burn offering made by fire unto the Lord, so shall they wash their hands and their feet, that they die not. And it shall be a statute forever to them, even to him and to his seed throughout their generations. So God said to the Levitical priesthood, but also to Israel, He said there's a time when you have to wash. And you have to do this washing. So, as it says in Hebrews, the verse we started with, diverse washings and cardinal or carnal ordinances. So there was a washing under the law, and God told the people under the law, there are times you have to wash. I think it was 80-something times I found the word wash in the King James Bible, and I went through and looked at each one of those passages, and God is telling him over and over, you got to wash yourself. You're unclean. You got to wash yourself. You got to bathe. You got to cleanse your body, your flesh, your outward part. But all that was under the law. All that was under there. So this is where the water was. The water was under the law. And it was for Jews, for Israel. Okay? So water is for Israel. Now what happened? Well, as you read through the Bible, you know that before Jesus came, up showed John the Baptist. Now why is he called the Baptist? Well, because old John baptized people. And how did he baptize people? In water. So old John the Baptist baptized in water. And what happened with John? Well, if you go to Luke chapter 16 and verse 16, the Bible tells us the law and the prophets were until John. Now, how interesting is that? The law and the prophets were until John. It's almost like God is saying there's a transition period taking place here from the law to the ministry of old John the Baptist. So what was it that John the Baptist did? What did he bring? What was it that God used him for? What was his ministry? Well, let's go to Matthew chapter 3. We started in Matthew chapter 3. Let's go back to Matthew chapter 3 because there's a little bit more information here. In Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, John the Baptist was prophesied of in the Bible that he would come. And we read about that. He's prophesied of in the book of Isaiah. I'm going to read Matthew 3, verses 1 through 6. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, or Isaias it says, but Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. And then it says in verse 5, then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. So John the Baptist was a Jew, and he went to Jews. And old John the Baptist was preaching, and he was preaching, repent and be baptized in water. So John the Baptist was preaching this message of repent. And they were literally repenting their sins when they got baptized in water. Picture that, if you will. I'm an adulterer, splash. I committed fornication, splash. I was a liar, splash. And every time he put them under, they were confessing what they were guilty of before God. Now, is that how we're saved today? Not on your life. We aren't saved by being baptized in water, someone holding our nose and pushing us under as we're giving our sins. I'm a liar. That's not salvation for us today. Yet there are churches that believe that and preach that today. Let's continue. Going back to verse 11. And we read this earlier. Verse 11. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. So while there was water washings in the Old Testament under the law, and John the Baptist came with the water washings, he made a distinction of the water and said, even though I baptize with water, there will be one comes that baptizes with the Holy Spirit. So you see the distinction between the two? So this at one time was for repentance. It was to show, I really do repent. And by proving that I really do repent, I will go down in the water and come up. As a type of showing God that I'm really, really am sorry for what I've done. Now, who didn't get baptized under John the Baptist? The Pharisees. The Pharisees looked at that and said, we're not going to confess our sins, because they were the most sinful of all the people. They were lying religious hypocrites. So they refused to follow John the Baptist, and they refused to believe that he was a prophet. Well, what did John the Baptist do? Well, let's go over to John chapter 1, learn a little bit more about John the Baptist, because Jesus had a lot to say about John the Baptist, and a lot of good stuff to say. Matter of fact, he said that among men born of women, there's none greater than John the Baptist. So John must have been an awesome person. Now if we go to John chapter 1, verse 14, I'll begin reading. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus Christ was full of grace and truth, and today we're saved by grace. That's the truth. We're not saved by water baptism. And it says, John bare witness of Him and cried, saying, This was He of whom I spake, that He who cometh after me is preferred before me, for He was before me. And of His fullness have all we received in grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Now, we're going to go a little bit farther in this chapter and start in verse 23. And I'm going to show you what the Bible teaches is the reason, the only reason, that God told John to do this water baptism. Because all this water baptism that John did was for a specific purpose. What was the specific purpose for this water baptism? So let's go to John chapter 1 and begin reading verse 23. And here John is speaking, and he said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Esaias, which is Isaiah. And they which were of the Pharisees, and they which were sent of the Pharisees, and they asked him and said unto him, Why baptizest thou then, if thou be not that Christ, nor Elias, nor that prophet? John answered them, saying, I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you whom ye know not. It is he who, coming after me, is preferred before me, whose shoe latchet I am not worthy to unloose, is not worthy to tie. These things were done in Bethabara beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, verse 29, John seeth Jesus coming to him and saith, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. He points them to Jesus, not to himself. Why did John say, Who taketh away the sin of the world? Why is Jesus the one who taketh away the sin of the world? Why didn't John the Baptist say, Behold, here comes Jesus, but he doesn't matter because water takes away your sins? You see, today people preach that you baptize in water and that takes away your sin. The Catholic Church believes in infant baptism, in which they say you baptize an infant in water and that takes away their original sin. Well, that's never found in the Scriptures. That's not in the Bible. So John says it's Jesus that takes away the sin of the world. How? Through water? No, through this other red, rich, sticky liquid. That's what takes away our sin, as we shall see. So John the Baptist never says that water baptism is what saves you. Now, what does he say in verse 31? In verse 31, he says, And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. This is the reason, verse 31, that John says he came baptizing in water. It was so that he may make Jesus Christ manifest to Israel. So the purpose of water baptism by John was to point people to Jesus Christ. And so Jesus came and was baptized in water in front of all the others. Why? To show the people that he was like them. He was in the same form as them, yet without sin. He took on a human body, and he was showing the people, I'm just like you. And so the whole reason that this water baptism thing took place under the ministry of John was to point people to Jesus Christ. And so Jesus Christ was baptized. I won't go into the story and read it here. But when he did, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit came down like a dove. And a voice from heaven said, This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. You have the Trinity there. God the Father speaking, God the Son being baptized, and God the Holy Spirit descending like a dove upon Jesus Christ. Where does that leave all these people that say there's no such thing as a Trinity? Obviously, there's a Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And they're all manifested in three different ways. But they're one God with three parts. So, this is what the Bible tells about baptism. Baptism was always a thing for the Jews. They always had to clean themselves under the law. And then God sent John the Baptist. He said, Hey, I want them to be cleansed. I want them to go get washed. And I want them to feel sorry for their sin and repent. And by cleansing their body, I want them to show me that they're serious. And so they got baptized. But the whole reason it was set up was to point to the Son of God, to the Messiah that's coming. So the baptism of John was to show Israel that Jesus was indeed their Messiah. I hope you understand that. I mean, that's really simple. I'm not giving you anything that no one's ever heard before. I mean, this is just sound biblical doctrine from the Bible about baptism. So John baptized in water to make Jesus manifest to Israel. He was pointing the Jewish race, the Jewish people, to their Messiah. And Jesus came and he said, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is him." And so they should have seen that. They should have accepted that. Well, now let's look at the ministry of Jesus. Matthew 15:24 says, and this is Jesus speaking, Jesus says in Matthew 15:24, "I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel." So Jesus started his ministry, and to whom was he sent? Just as John the Baptist went to Jews, Jesus Christ went only to Jews. He said, "I'm not sent to anyone else." So Jesus Christ came born of a virgin as a Jew, and his ministry, just like John's ministry, was to Jewish people. So Jesus Christ showed up. And let's go to John chapter 3, verse 22 and 23. After Jesus was baptized of John, Jesus went around and chose his disciples. And his disciples began to baptize people in water. John chapter 3, verse 22. "And after these things came Jesus and his disciples unto the land of Judea," where the Jews are, "and there he tarried with them and baptized. And John also was baptizing in Enon near to Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized." So Jesus was with his disciples. They were baptizing in one place. John with his disciples were baptizing in another place. But now go to John chapter 4. And I want to show you something so important. John chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. "Did you know that Jesus Christ baptized no one? Not once in Jesus' ministry did he ever take somebody and dunk them underwater. Why is that?" John chapter 4. "When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, comma, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples." Why does the Bible tell us that? Why is it so dogmatic? Why is it that only the disciples of Jesus were the ones doing water baptism? Why was it that Jesus never baptized anyone in water? Well, because Jesus came for a purpose, and as we saw, even John the Baptist said, "I indeed baptize with water, but he comes one after who baptized with the Holy Spirit." So even though the water was taking place here, there was going to be a time in the future when the baptism of the Holy Spirit was going to take place. And that was more important than this baptism over here. So we see a transition from the water baptism to the Holy Spirit baptism. Do you see where I'm coming from? So as you read through the Bible, it's easy to understand why there's people that teach water baptism saves. It's because they want to be over here under these ministries. But you know what they do? They forget the fact that Jesus Christ died and shed his blood. And that we're over here. We're not back here anymore. So this water baptism for salvation does not save us. We're saved by the gospel, what Jesus did. And we'll get to that in a minute. So let's continue. Jesus dies. In his ministry, Jesus Christ goes to the cross. He sheds his blood. He says, "It is finished." What's finished? The one sacrifice forever for sins. And so then what happens? Well, Jesus Christ rises from the dead. And let's go to Acts chapter 1 and see what Jesus says after he rises from the dead. Acts chapter 1 and verse 5, Jesus rises again from the dead, and in verse 5 he says, "For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days thence. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth." And then what happened? Jesus Christ rose and went up into heaven. So we see something taking place here. They ask him, will the kingdom come? You see, Jesus has got a kingdom way out here in the millennium for 1,000 years, which he's been prophesied that he'll rule. And so they're asking, well, is that going to take place here? And it didn't. But it could have. So as the book of Acts starts, it's still Jews going to Jews. Every one of the disciples of Jesus Christ was a Jew. So So here these Jews go out to Jews. And the first thing Peter does when he goes to those Jews is start giving the same message that John the Baptist gave. Repent and be baptized. Let's look at that. Before we do, let's go to Matthew 28. Matthew 28. And then we'll go look at that. Matthew chapter 28. I get ahead of myself sometimes. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Now watch this. Matthew 28, 19 and 20. Go ye therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. So after Jesus rose again, he told his disciples, go into all nations and baptize them and teach them what I, Jesus, told you. So now we see the Jews, after the death of Jesus Christ, going out, and they got a different baptism. They were baptized in water back here, but over here they were baptized with the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit. So there was a different baptism. So now you've got two different baptisms taking place at the same time. There's a water baptism going on, and then there's the Holy Ghost baptism going on. Over here, there was only one. Way back here, it was just the one. It was the water. And then you have Jesus over here. He had the baptism of suffering as he suffered on the cross. So there's more than one baptism in the Bible. Acts chapter 2, in verse 38 through 41. Peter stands up and begins to preach. And in Acts chapter 2 and verse 38, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. So here we have Peter preaching. And what does he tell them? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. So he's telling them, get the water. And he says, if you're baptized in the water, then you'll get the Holy Ghost. And there are churches today that preach this as the plan of salvation. And they tell you, you have to be baptized in water to be saved. But do you realize that the book of Acts has 28 chapters? And this is just the second chapter? What are they doing? They're not reading. They're not studying. They're not rightly dividing. Because as you read the book of Acts, you find out that the book of Acts is a transitional book. There is a transition taking place in the book of Acts. And that transition is what we're going to look at now. Because it changes a little bit more. Unless you understand this, you can be deceived and end up in hell. I know somebody that I care a lot about that believes that they're going to heaven because they've been baptized in water. As a minister, I've come across a lot of people, and I ask for their testimony. They say, well, I was baptized, so I'm good. If they just read the Bible, they would realize that that baptism was for Jews. Look at Acts 2:38 again. Let me read the verse right before it. Acts 2:37. Now when they, Jews, heard this, they, Jews, were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Peter, a Jew, is preaching to Jews with the apostles, and the Jewish nation says, men and brethren, what shall we do? So this message of water to receive the Holy Spirit was a message to Jews. Now, is this the same message for us today? Is this the same plan of salvation in the church age? Do we really get saved by washing ourselves in water? There's a church here in town called the Church of Christ. Actually, there's two of them. One in Baghdad, one over in Milton. My dad visited the one in Baghdad one time, and my dad sat down and said, hey, Pastor, I want to ask you a question. He says, how do you believe a person gets saved and has their sins washed away? And the pastor said, well, water baptism. And so my dad says, so you really believe that being baptized in water will give you eternal life and wash your sins away? He said, yes. My dad said, okay, well, what if I go up the road to the one over on Margaret Street and I get baptized there? Is that good? And listen to this. This is what the pastor said. He said, no. He said, that's a different church. It's only our church that can save. So unless you're baptized in this church here, you can never be saved. So my dad said, so do you mean if I was baptized in that church over there, I'm not going to heaven? And the pastor said, no, you can only go to heaven if you're baptized in my church right here. You realize how ridiculous that is? Very few people will ever get saved according to that man if that's what he believes. Is that what the Bible teaches? Does the Bible teach that water baptism gets you to heaven? If we can get saved by being baptized in water, why did Jesus die? You ever think about that? I thought we were supposed to believe what Jesus did. Why is he telling us to do something else? Why did Jesus come to this earth and die if you could be saved by baptism? Why didn't he just say, come here, prophet, I want you to go around and tell everybody to get baptized, and as soon as they get baptized, they'll be saved. You see, it was all for Jews, and it was all to point the Jews to the Messiah. And here, it was all to point back to the Messiah. What Peter was preaching was, hey, you killed your Messiah. Now, if you feel bad about it, get baptized in water to show that you repent. To show that it's a sign of repentance, that you're sorry that you killed your Messiah. That's what it's all about. Now, as we continue through the book of Acts, we see a change. We see a transition in the book of Acts. Peter and the apostles are in chapter 2. We skip ahead 3, 4, 5, 6. In Acts chapter 7, up shows a guy named Stephen. And Stephen begins to preach to Israel. And when he does, he tells them, you guys did this, 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 and this. And in Acts chapter 7 and verse 55, right before they stone Stephen, which is the Jewish nation as a whole, saying, we reject your message, we reject the Messiah. Right as they were stoning Stephen in verse 55, it tells us that he looked up in heaven, he saw Jesus Christ standing on the right hand of God. Now, other verses in the New Testament, Jesus is sitting on the right hand of God. But here, in Acts chapter 7, Jesus Christ is standing on the right hand of God. There was a possibility that right there, had the Jews accepted their Messiah as a nation, that Jesus would have come back right there, none of this would have existed, the tribulation would have taken place right here, and then Jesus' millennial reign would have happened right there. But because they rejected him, they rejected Jesus Christ, God said, from now on then, I'm going to do something. I'm going to take to the Gentiles the message of salvation. And notice that the message that God took to the Gentiles was different from the message that God started with the Jews. God told the Jews, Acts 2:38. What is that? Repent and be baptized in water. But when God said to the Gentiles to be saved, it was 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. No longer was salvation by water. It's by believing or by faith in the gospel. And we'll look at that. We'll look at what the gospel is. So, briefly, let's quickly look through here. Acts chapter 7, Stephen is stoned. In Acts chapter 8, God calls a guy named Philip and says, hey, go talk to this Ethiopian eunuch. What's an Ethiopian eunuch? An Ethiopian would be a Gentile, someone from down in Africa. And what is he told? Well, you go to Acts chapter 8 and verse 35. Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their certain way, they came to a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? Now, Philip does not say the same thing that Peter said. Philip does not say in verse 37, yeah, if you repent and believe and be baptized, you'll receive the Holy Ghost. Notice what Philip says. Philip says in verse 37, which, by the way, is missing in the new versions of the Bible, the NIV. And Philip said, if thou believest, verse 37, with all thine heart thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. So here, in chapter 8, is the start of no longer do you receive the Holy Spirit by being baptized in water. No longer. Here you have to believe in Jesus, and then after you believe was water baptism. Now notice that. First, when the Acts started, how did you receive the Holy Ghost? By water baptism. But now, since the Jews as a whole, God said, okay, they've rejected me, now I'll take the gospel to the rest of the world. Then God says you must believe. Salvation is by faith, is by believing. And after they believed, that's when they were baptized in water. Now some will say, well, the water baptism is what gave them the Holy Spirit. Oh, really? All right, let's watch this. Let's go to Acts chapter 10. And if you know your Bible, in Acts chapter 10, Peter preaches to Cornelius. a Gentile. And look what it says, Acts chapter 10, verse 39, whom they slew and hung on a tree. Verse 40, him God raised up the third day and showed him openly. Well, that sounds like the gospel, death, burial, resurrection. Verse 43, to him give all the prophets witness that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. Verse 44, while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word. Now verse 46, and they heard them speak with, they spake with tongues, and magnify God, then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then prayed they to him to tarry certain days. So here we have faith. They believed. As soon as they believed, they received the Holy Spirit. After they received the Holy Spirit, then they were baptized in water. Do you see the transition? Do you see the change? So everybody who thinks that baptism in water today saves, they have not read the rest of the Bible. Because there is a transition taking place in the book of Acts from Jews to Gentiles, from the early apostles to a new apostle named Paul that God chose to be the apostle to the Gentiles. As we continue on, we see this pattern time and again in the book of Acts. Someone believes, and as soon as they believe, they receive the Holy Spirit, and they're baptized after they're saved, not baptism for salvation. Peter is speaking in chapter 11 of Acts. And Peter says in verse 15, and as I began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on them as on us at the beginning. Then remembered I the word of the Lord, how that he said, John indeed baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. For as much then as God gave them the like gift as he did unto us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God? When they heard these things, they held their peace and glorified God, saying, then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. But they didn't get repentance by being baptized in water. When they believed, they received the Holy Spirit. That water thing they did afterwards. But it was not part of salvation. So water baptism is not part of salvation. Go to Acts chapter 16. Here we see the Apostle Paul, which, by the way, in Romans 11:13, Paul says he was the apostle to the Gentiles. God's called him to be an apostle to the Gentiles. In Acts chapter 16 and verse 30, there was a man who wanted to be saved. And the question this man asks is, sirs, what must I do to be saved? He's asking Paul and Silas, hey, what do I need to do to be saved? Well, if it were Acts chapter 2, then Paul would have said, repent and be baptized, and you shall receive the Holy Ghost. But it's not Acts chapter 2, it's Acts chapter 16. There's been something taking place that changed everything, and it went from Jews to Gentiles, and so the answer is different. And the answer is, verse 31, and they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved at thy house. The house needs to believe on Jesus Christ as well. So after they believed, then they were baptized, verse 33. So you see the change in the Bible. That's why there's so many denominations today that don't preach Acts 2:38. Instead, they preach Acts 16:30-31. And they preach salvation first, and then baptism. They would do the water thing after you're saved. Now, as we continue, we find out even more. Today, we're under Paul's ministry. God chose a man named Paul. And God gave the gospel to Paul, and the gospel is 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. In Romans chapter 2, God says, I believe it's 2:16, that the whole world will be judged according to Paul's gospel. That is, God has turned from the preaching of water baptism to the preaching of salvation by grace through faith alone. Let's go ahead and read 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4 is the gospel. And here we read, moreover, brethren, this is the Apostle Paul, our apostle, according to Romans 11:13, apostles to the Gentiles. He says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, how that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. So the gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And you must believe that what Jesus did is sufficient to save you. Let's go to Acts chapter 13. Once again, remember the change in the book of Acts. No longer was Acts 2:38 preached. It was only preached to Jews, and then it changed. I believe it's in Acts 13 is what I want you to find. In Acts chapter 13, look at this. Acts chapter 13 and verse 38. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man, Jesus, is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. Now watch this, verse 39. And by him all that believe are justified from all things from which ye could not be justified by the law of Moses. So this salvation message, this gospel, is for justification. You see, it's not something that you do. Back here, you had to be baptized in water. That was the work that you had to do. In fact, we even read it where he said, save yourself from this untoward generation. So you had to save yourself by being baptized in water. But as God revealed the gospel, as the book of Acts went along, God says, look, it's not by what you do, it's by trusting what I did. Trusting, because I did it all for you. So to tell someone that they're saved by water baptism is to tell them to do a work to be saved, which says the work of Jesus is not sufficient. But to understand the Bible and to be saved is to say, oh, water baptism does not save me. The work of Jesus saves me because it's sufficient. Because it's the only thing that can give me justification and salvation in the eyes of God. So, we are under the ministry of Paul today. And as you look at what Paul said about baptism, you find some very interesting things. Go to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. I hope everyone understands what I'm saying here. You can't understand the Bible until you understand the change, until you rightly divide and see the transition period in the book of Acts. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, the Bible tells us how we receive the Holy Spirit today. And no longer is Acts 2:38 how we're saved today. No, we're saved by the gospel. Ephesians 1:13 says, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. So back here in Acts 2:38, to these Jews, if they wanted the Holy Spirit, they had to get baptized in water. But we are out here, under the ministry of Paul, the books of Romans through Philemon. And if we want the Holy Spirit, we have to believe or trust the gospel. That's how we get baptized. We get baptized with the Holy Spirit. It's not the water baptism that saves. It's the Holy Spirit baptism. And when do you receive the Holy Spirit? When you believe the gospel. That's what Ephesians 1:13. Now, I mention this because there are out there people that call themselves Pentecostals or Charismatics. And they do the same thing that the Church of Christ does. They like to hang around in the early books of Acts. They don't see the transition. And so they say, no, you can only get the Holy Spirit when you speak in tongues. Well, I don't have time to go into that. Go to thecloudchurch.org, look under where it says the Why I'm Not series, and find out why I'm not a Pentecostal. I used to be in the Assembly of God Church till I realized they were telling me to do something to get the Holy Spirit. They told me speak in tongues to get the Holy Spirit. But that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches through Paul and his gospel that the moment you believe, the moment you are saved, you do receive the Holy Spirit of promise, and that's why you are baptized with the Holy Spirit. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13. The Bible tells us about this baptism in the Holy Spirit. The moment you are saved by believing the gospel today, here, is when you're baptized. 1 Corinthians 12, 13 says, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink unto one Spirit. So the baptism for us in this period is the Holy Spirit baptism. You see, it's not the water baptism that saves us. Now notice what I said. We're not saved by water today. We're saved by faith in the blood. Because that's what the gospel is. The gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection. It's all about the blood. Without shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. Jesus shed his blood. And we must trust the blood. And when we trust the blood, we're trusting the gospel. And to trust the blood is the way to receive eternal life. When you trust the blood, you're baptized with the Holy Spirit of promise. Now, go to Ephesians chapter 4. In verse 5, Paul tells us very plainly that we're no longer in this time where you had to have water baptism to be baptized with the Holy Ghost. We are only baptized by the Holy Ghost by belief, by trusting, not by water. That's why he says in Ephesians chapter 4, I'll start in verse 4 and 5, "For there is one body, one spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And that one baptism is spirit baptism." We are saved, and the moment we're saved, we are baptized with the Holy Spirit of God. So today, water baptism is not part of salvation. I want you to get that. It does not save you. If you are claiming to be a Christian, but you're trusting in your water baptism, and you say, "Well, I'm going to heaven because I've been baptized in water," you are lost. You are deceived. You are trusting in something you did, saying, "God has to accept me because I did it." And God's up in heaven saying, "I don't care what you did. Look what I did for you." You see, getting saved is trusting what Jesus did. Nothing that you do. See yourself as you are, a sinner, and trust only in what Jesus did. So what did Paul say about water baptism? Well, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Now, this might make some people mad, and that's fine. I'm not trying to make anyone mad. I'm just trying to show the scriptures. Amen? What did this guy, Paul, who is our apostle, have to say about this water baptism? Well, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, "I thank God that I baptized none of you but Crispus and Gaius." Now, if we are saved today by water baptism, then what a horrible apostle to say, "Man, I thank God I baptized none of you except these over here." Why would he say that if you are saved by water? Well, because he's saying you're not saved by water. So I'm glad I didn't baptize you in water so that you wouldn't end up thinking, "Oh, well, I'm saved because I'm saved by water baptism." He says, "The reason I'm glad I didn't baptize any of you is verse 15, lest any should say that I had baptized in my own name." He says, "And I baptized also the house of Stephanus, besides I know not whether I baptized any other." The greatest apostle the world's ever known, Paul, is saying, "You know, I didn't baptize too many people in water." Why? Well, because of verse 17. "Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not with the wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the spirit, preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved is the power of God." So Paul is telling us that water is not what saves you, and that the emphasis for salvation is on the gospel of Jesus Christ. He said, "I was sent to preach the gospel, not to do what Peter did in the beginning of Acts, go around and baptize in water." You're saved and baptized in the Holy Spirit. He says there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. The one baptism is the Holy Spirit baptism. Now you say, "Well, what about being baptized after you're saved?" A lot of churches today, if you want to be a member of that church, they say you have to be baptized. But many of them will try to preach the gospel and say it's after you're saved. So they'll say, "If you'll be baptized in water afterwards, then we'll accept you as a member of our church." Now if they want to do that, they can help themselves. But the sad thing is, there's still people out there that don't understand what the gospel is. And that's what's so sad, is to see people that get into a religious organization and they get baptized. Let me give you an example. A friend of mine told me he went to a church one time, and it was a big, big, huge church. And they supposedly preached the gospel and salvation by faith. And the moment you believe, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit. But they baptized people after they were saved. But many of the people in that church, they were very shallow soul winners, so they wouldn't give the gospel clearly. And lots of times they tell people, "You know, just repeat this prayer after me, or do this or do that." And a lot of people end up trusting in something other than Jesus. A lot of times people trust in their prayer. So this pastor was doing a baptism service on a Sunday, and he was baptizing all these people. And he had this one guy, and he said, "Well, man, how does it feel? What do you think?" And he's holding this guy's hand in the baptismal pool. He says, "Well, what do you think?" And the guy says, "Well, I'm just glad to finally have my sins washed away." And the pastor went, "Oh, boy," and dunked him as soon as he could. Because he knew that that guy wasn't saved. And he knew he didn't want to go, well, we need to pick. He wanted to brag about how many people he had baptized that Sunday. And that's what water baptism has become today. Bragging rights. And I used to belong to a big, huge denomination where all they did was talk about how many people they baptized. And it's almost like they don't even care if the person's truly saved or not. As long as they can dunk them underwater, they can brag. And you've seen it probably as well as I. Hey, man, our church had 800 baptisms last month, or last year. Oh, yeah, well, we had 1,700 baptisms. And all they do is brag about water. No. I'm sorry, I'm going to brag about Jesus. Whether you get baptized in water, I could care less. I'm like the Apostle Paul. I want to know that you're saved. Now you say, are you against water baptism? I didn't say that. I'm not saying I am or I'm not. I'm just saying what the Bible says. And the Apostle Paul says, God sent me not to baptize but to preach the gospel. So I'm not even going to worry about the water. What I'm worried about is, are you trusting the gospel? Are you saved? Have you trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior? That's all that matters. That's the most important thing. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians. I've got to close. But if you understand the truth of the gospel and the truth of the Bible, then your emphasis would be the same emphasis as the Bible. And the Bible puts the emphasis on the gospel. Yet churches today try to put the emphasis on water. Many of them say the water itself is the saving medium. That's anti-biblical. Others say, no, you got to believe and then you have to be baptized in water. And yet they glory in your water baptism, but they won't glory in the fact that you believe the gospel. I just want to glory in Jesus. All I want to know is Christ crucified. That's what Paul said. Well, the last one here is the baptism of fire. And if you're not saved, that's where you're going to end up. In a place where you would to God you had water. And in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, the Bible tells us what will happen to those who aren't saved when the rapture takes place. And I believe we're very close to the rapture. Maybe I'm talking to someone here who's not saved. Listen to what this says. And to you who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. In flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. There's going to be a day, if you're not saved, and Jesus returns at Armageddon, or maybe you die before Jesus comes, you're going to be baptized, whether you want to be or not. If you're lost, you're going to fall down into the flames of the damned. And the fiery flames of hell will lick your never-dying soul as you're immersed in the pain and the anguish of the flames of everlasting destruction. You'll burn for all eternity. It's called eternal fire in Jude 1:7. And Hebrews 12:29 says, our God is a consuming fire. If you reject Jesus Christ, if you reject the gospel of salvation, you'll be immersed in hell, burning and crying out to God, oh, that I had just one drop of water. So what is salvation? Salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ. A lot of people want to make the saving medium this liquid called water. But the truth of the matter is, according to the Bible, the saving medium is another liquid, and the liquid is the blood of Jesus Christ. 1 John 1:7 says, the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sins. In Ephesians 1:7, it tells us that in whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sins. We're not forgiven through water baptism. We don't have redemption and salvation through water. We don't even receive the Holy Ghost through the water baptism like they did then. We're over here. And God is clear through the preachings of Paul, through the teachings of Paul, that the only way to be saved, the only way to receive the Holy Spirit, is by trusting the gospel of Jesus Christ, trusting the shed blood. And it's the blood of Jesus that washes our sins away. I love what it says in Acts 20:28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood. You see, if we're saved by water baptism, why did Jesus die? Why did he shed his blood? What for? Why didn't he just stay up in heaven? Why did he come down to have this baptism of suffering? Why didn't he just stay up in heaven and say, hey, John, I'm up here. You go down there and just tell everybody to dunk themselves in the water. And then when they do, I'll save them. He didn't do that. He had to come. He had to die. Because that's the only way to be saved. Trust what Jesus did. If you can save yourself through water baptism, why did Jesus die? If water saves, then why did he shed his blood? It's only through faith that you can be saved today. So which one of these baptisms do you want? If you want to think that you're saved by water, you're going to go to hell. And you're going to know this baptism of fire. You're going to know it all too well. If you want to be saved, then you have to look at Christ who suffered for you, shed his blood. And you trust the gospel, his death, burial, and resurrection. Trust his shed blood for the justification for your sins. And you will have eternal life. So that's the message today. I hope it's been clear. It all points to this right here. This is salvation, what Jesus did. And the only liquid that wash our sins away is not water. Water touches the body and gets the body wet. You'll die and go to hell wet. The only liquid that can save you and wash your sins away is the blood of Jesus Christ, because the blood is the only thing that can touch the soul and wash your sins away. Are you saved today? If not, you need to come to Jesus Christ. Trust him as your Savior. If you are saved, please listen to this and understand this. If you want to be baptized in water, that's fine. As long as you don't trust that for salvation. You do whatever you want to do. But don't trust in water. Trust in what Jesus said. Because Jesus said, trust him and you can be baptized with the Holy Spirit by faith. So thanks for watching. We'll see you back next time on thecloudchurch.org. I hope this was an understandable sermon. And I hope that if there's anybody out there that thinks water baptism saves, this sermon will show you it's not the water, it's the blood. It's all about the blood of Jesus Christ. God bless you. We'll see you back next time.